السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وأطهر المرسلين، شفيع المذنبين وحبيب رب العالمين محمد، صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وتركها على المحجة البيضاء لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Most Merciful, all praise is due to Allah. We bear witness that no one is worthy of worship but Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indeed his final messenger. The best of speech is the book of Allah, and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who listen to the best of speech, the book of Allah, and follow its commands. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst those who come to know the best of ways, the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and make us amongst his followers. Ya ahbaba Rasulillahi sallallahu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi, yudhakkirun al-Qur'an bi-ni'mati al-ma' fi akthar min 60 mawdi'in fi kitabillah. In more than 60 places in the Qur'an, Allah reminds us of his benevolence and of his mercy, specifically when it comes to the issue of water. To be exact, in 63 different places in the Quran, Allah reminds man of the benevolence and the mercy of him by providing water to man. أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ لو نشاء جعلناه أجاجا أفلا تشكرون. So that, have you considered, ever, have you pondered about the water that you drink? Are you the ones who brought it down from the clouds, or were we the ones who brought it down from the clouds? لو نشاء جعلناه أجاجا. Had it been our will, we would have indeed made it very bitter. Therefore, be grateful and thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In numerous places, like we said, in 63 different places, the Quran reminds us of water. Not just in the form of rain, but also the Quran speaks about al-anhar. وَذُكِرَتْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ فِي أَكْثَرَ مِنْ 50 مَوْضَعٍ. Allah speaks about rivers. And in the Quran, rivers are mentioned over 50 times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of rivers. كلمة البحر والبحار في كتاب الله وردت في أكثر من 40 موضع. The word sea and its derivatives in the plural and in the singular form is mentioned in the Quran in over 40 places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this beauty of water. Not only that, but the Quran argues, وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَ كُلَّ دَابَّةٍ مِّن مَاءٍ. And Allah created every creature from water. Another place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. And indeed we have made every living being thing out of water. So much so that it's very common among scientists that they are arguing, that they are entertaining that the origin of life was actually aquatic. Aquatic origin of life. Which seems that the Quran is suggesting, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. And out of water we made every living being. In our own selves as human beings, we are mostly water. We are reminded that at the time of our birth, the weight of a human being is 80% water. As adults, 67% of our body weight is actually water. 73% of our brain is actually made out of water. So we would look into this and we would say, Subhanallah, indeed the Quran spoke the truth. 25% of our bones are actually water as well. And that goes to all the organs. So when we speak about water, we are speaking about what makes it possible for us to be and to survive. So much so that they say that a human being can actually live without food for about a month. But we cannot live without water for more than 1 week. A good amount of things that we see around us are actually made up of water. I just learned that 25% of the weight of a chicken is actually water. 95% of a tomato is actually water. 80% of a pineapple is water. And Allah reminds us, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. Indeed, we have made out of water every living being. So much so, وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَ كُلَّ دَابَّةٍ مِّن مَّاءٍ. The origin of every living being we are reminded of in the Quran is actually water. So much so that the Prophet ﷺ spoke about water and about nature. A Dutch scientist by the name of Francisca de Selva, she wrote and she said that Muhammad ﷺ has been the greatest friend of the environment. And she said that most of the words that we use today, conserving and protecting and going green, she said that we think that these are statements that are just we are just making now. But she said that in reality, if you go back and you read the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find out that the Prophet, peace be upon him, was indeed an environmentalist. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma min muslimin yazra'u zar'an aw yaghrisu gharsan fayakulu minhu insanun aw haywan illa kana lahu bihi ajrun sadaqa ila yawm al-qiyamah aw kama qala sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Said that every time a believer plants a tree or puts down a seed and that grows to be a tree, and then humans either eat from it or they sit under its shade, or that animals come and they eat of it, she said the Prophet ﷺ said that this will be a form of charity that is continuous for him or her as long as that tree is in existence. And subhanAllah, he's always wondering about this idea of planting a tree. Why would the Prophet ﷺ speak so much about planting a tree? And subhanAllah, he would know that even though about 73% of the surface of the earth is actually covered with water. And they said that most of the surface water on earth is not good for our consumption. Only 3% of it is good for our consumption. The water that we really need, that we depend on, 80% of it is actually below the ground. And 1% of it is suspended. It's up in the atmosphere. So 1% is up there, and then the 5% that we use is underground, and the surface of the earth is actually water, but it's not good for our consumption. So why am I saying this in relation to what the Prophet ﷺ said? Said that every time a tree is planted, every single day, that tree helps in evaporating 25 gallons of water every single day. So the Prophet ﷺ would encourage the people and say, be amongst those who plant down the trees. That beautiful hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا قَامَتِ السَّاعَةِ, if it's being announced that the day of judgment has arrived. Now you would think a religious man would tell people to do what? Run to the mosque. Make sure you make it to the synagogue. Don't ever leave the church. You go to that place. What does Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said? إِذَا قَامَتِ السَّاعَةِ وَفِي يَدِ أَحَدِكُمْ فَسِيلًا إِنْ إِسْتَطَاعَ أَنْ يَغْرِسَ أَوْ يَزْرَعَهَ فَلْيَغْرِسَ أَوْ لِيَزْرَعَهَ صَلُّ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Said that when the day of judgment is being announced, he didn't say run to these places or make sure that you fast or make sure that you are ritually pure. He didn't say that. He said that, and one of you has got a bushel or a seed in his hand, said that if he's got the time to plant it, said that let them plant it down there. These are the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet, peace be upon him, was very keen about the way that people use water and the water usage. And let me just get to the point very quickly. California is witnessing, as we speak, the worst droughts since 1895. In some places, the expected water level in reservoirs is below 40% of where it is supposed to be. And remember that technically a drought is a period of time when the level of water is not meeting the need of the people, or it is below what they call precipitation. And that can be for as little as 15 days, and people can announce that there is a drought going on, or sometimes it can take up to years. And sometimes they say that a short, intense drought can do more damage than by drought that has been there for over years, but it's mild. So California now is saying that since 1895 we are facing the worst droughts ever. In places, I think I've told some of you this before, in Glendora, it's being announced that you cannot water your lawn anymore. No more car wash. If you go to a restaurant there now, you know how it is that part of the service that the waiter or the waitress will come and they will offer you a glass of water immediately? So nowadays they will not give you the water unless you ask for it. Because there isn't really much out there to be wasted the way that we do it. But see, brothers and sisters, sometimes we become very heedless and we take these things for granted. And we do not pay attention that this is a very serious matter. So much so that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would teach the believers, and he would say, "La tusrif, do not be wasteful. Walau kana ahadukum ala nahrin jari." Said that do not be wasteful, even if you are standing by the shores of a running river. Now, if you're standing by the shores of a running river, you're just using the water, and the water is still in that river. So why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not be wasteful, or do not be excessive in your usage of that? Simply because do not develop the habit of disrespecting this beautiful gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, one of the observations that the author made, Francisca de Silva, the Dutch professor that I was telling you about, she said that we can understand why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam believed what he believed.
She said, because if you look into the teachings of the Quran, and she specifically mentions a verse in the Quran, and keep in mind that this is the person who's not a Muslim. She wrote a beautiful passage on water as a form of purity in Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. That was the theme of her paper. It was a beautiful, marvelous paper, where she would be quoting from the book of Leviticus and the Bible and in the Quran. But she said that we would know why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught what he taught if we were to consider the Quran that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was reciting. وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا وَلِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا فِيهِمْ. She said, because in the teachings of the Quran, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam understood that to Allah belongs the heaven and the earth and what is in between them, and to Allah belongs the heavens and the earth and what is in them. She said, as a result, everything around Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam belongs to Allah. So when you use, you better watch out what it is that you are using. This thing really belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she said, as a result, that was reflected in the teachings of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And the reason why the Prophet, peace be upon him, made that statement is that he was passing by a man that was making wudu. And the Prophet ﷺ said to the man, La tusrif, don't be wasteful. Don't do this excessively. And the man said with pride, Ya Rasulullah, innama atawadda. And said, Oh Prophet of Allah, I'm just making wudu. As if he is giving himself the legitimacy or the right that I'm not really wasting the water, I'm using it for something good. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, don't be wasteful even if you are making wudu on the shores of a running river. Don't do that. And now what the people are saying is the government and these politicians and people in authority are coming out and they say, look, you've got to take this very serious. Drought is a serious matter that has an impact on us economically speaking. Because what happens is that most of the farmers who depend on subsistence kind of agriculture, they migrate when that takes place. Livestock suffers as a result of drought. We as consumers now have to pay a higher price because there is less water, which means that there are less crops that are out there. And not only this, but many people depend on the corn that is grown here locally overseas. So now the problem is not only for us here, the problem is going to be global as well. Drought also means that there is going to be more risk for fire as well. Don't have enough fire to put it off, don't have enough fire to keep the crops and the trees out there green. So as a result, they become very dry. With the heat, then fire becomes also very easily erupted as well. SubhanAllah, just reading about this, they say that snake migration actually increases as a result of drought, and during drought seasons, snake bites also increase as well. So the issue is really serious. The issue is extremely serious. So what they have been saying is that they said, you have got to pay attention to the way that you use your water. Shocked to learn that the average person in the US, that is us by the way, not them, that is us, the average person in the US consumes anywhere between 80 to 100 gallons a day. That is 80 to 100 gallons per individual a day. In the same statistics, they said that a person in Jordan consumes 4 gallons of water a day. So you look into this and you say, wait a minute, but where is this water coming from? And they say that it is just about really being wasteful. It is about brushing your teeth while the tap is running. It is about us brushing the teeth and just really not turning off the faucet. Or it is about us, oh, my shower is very quick. Oh, how quick is your shower, brother or sister? It is about, I take about 5 minutes. That is 50 gallons of water. A shower that takes 5 minutes is at least 50 gallons of water. That is how much of it is being wasted. So there is an appeal that what we do is that, number one, we conserve. We must conserve our usage of water. Not because there is drought, but rather because these are the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, subhanAllah, the idea that this is a gift from Allah, And when people give us a gift, we are expected to put the gift in good use, at least to show appreciation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in the Quran, أَفَلَا تَشْكُرُونَ Won't you be grateful for this beautiful act of benevolence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extending to you humans, keeping in mind that your well-being, your life actually depends on it? So number one, they say, we must pay attention to the way that we use water. Please, brothers and sisters, as believers, as concerned citizens, it is our duty that our relationship with nature, especially our relationship with water, is one that is really based on appreciation and seeing it as a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Issue so serious that actually the religious leadership in the area, the Christians as well as the Muslims, they said that in our traditions, it is very common that when there is drought, that we beg of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was reviewing the teachings of a Maliki jurist by the name of Khalil, and he said, وَيُنْدَبُ لِأَهْلِ الْخَصْبِ أَنْ يَدْعُوا لِأَهْلِ الْجَدْبِ وَأَنْ يَسْتَسْقُوا لَهُمْ. He said that it is highly recommended in Islam that people who are living in good areas, where drought is really not a problem for them, that they ought to pray for those who are going through some hard, difficult times. So based on this, today was actually a day where the Mormons and the Muslims, they said, can we all fast? And on this day of Friday, let us pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alleviates the problems of the people who are suffering from this drought. And we look into this and we say that in our own Islamic tradition, this is beautiful. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has actually encouraged us to participate in the tradition of Salat al-Istisqa, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send the rain upon the people, be it us who are directly suffering from it, or be it other people who are far from us. So you would think that this is beautiful, and we Muslims, we are all for it. Because this is the tradition and the practice of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And they say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would invite people to pray out. Go outside and pray in the outside, and show humility. Don't come dressed up, but rather come looking humble. And when you do so, the Prophet ﷺ said, bring your children and bring your women and really just express how you are desperate for the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you think that this is acceptable until somebody came up and said that we as Muslims are actually not allowed to pray for rain or water that would help non-Muslims. Yes, you heard me right. Somebody actually said that we as Muslims are not permitted to pray for rain to come into the land and benefit the non-Muslims. Now, for those of you who know me, know that I have very little tolerance for stupidity. But subhanAllah, my tolerance for stupidity in the name of religion, that is even, it's just unfathomable. I cannot understand somebody legitimizing stupidity and cruelty in the name of Allah. So that, oh, it's, if the drought involves non-Muslims, don't pray for them. Are you serious? Are you serious? You really expect me to believe that the man who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about مَعْبَبْعُوثْ رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, he was sent as a mercy to mankind, would teach, do not pray for non-Muslims who are suffering from drought. You really expect to believe this? But the bigger disaster is, when you look into the teachings of Muslim jurists, you find that this has never been the case. There is so much tolerance that the person that I just quoted, you Mukhtasar Khalil, وَقَالَ خَلِيلُ فِي مُخْتَصَرِهِ وَيُسَنُّ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ أَنْ يَخْرُجُوا وَيُصَلُّوا وَأَنْ يَخْرُجَ مَعَهُمُ النَّصَارَى بِصُلْبَانِهِمْ وَأَنْ يَخْرُجَ مَعَهُمُ الْيَهُودُ بِمَزَادِيرِهِمْ وَأَنْ يَدْعُوا اللَّهَ كَبَشَرٍ وَكَإِنْسَانٍ. So that it is highly recommended that people just go and beg of Allah, the Muslims go and beg of Allah, said and invite the Christians to come along with them. And he said, and then the Christians say that, we want to come, but we want to come with our crosses. He said, let it be. Said, let the Christians join with their crosses, and let the Jews join with their trumpets as well, he said. These are the teachings of somebody like Khalil, who wrote his book 800 years ago, and he said, that's not the point, man. The point is that we are all equally suffering. And if we are blessed, we are all blessed. And even if it was not us who are suffering, and somebody else is suffering, he said, let us pray for those who are suffering. SubhanAllah, sometimes, you know, these statements, sometimes as evil as they are, but they really force us into going back and being able to pull out these types of jewels from our deed. That somebody like Khalil would specify and he would say, وَأَنْ يَخْرُجَ النَّصَارَى بِصُلْبَانِهِمْ وَأَنْ يَخْرُجَ الْيَهُودِ بِمَزَعْبِرِهِمْ. And your statement like this of Khalil, that the Christians come out with their crosses and the Jews with their trumpets, would have just been forgotten. Had it not been for a statement like this one, we would have really not known or appreciated that statement. So on this day, wallahi, we truly pray that to begin with, that we pay more attention to our relationship with nature, especially our relationship with water. And I encourage myself and all of you brothers and sisters, please let us pay attention how it is that we deal with water and show water more respect. Not just throwing it, not just wasting it, but rather, you know what, can I really make every single drop count? Say that in a single day, if you have a faucet that is dripping, you are wasting about 75 liters of water. Fix it. Fix it. Not because it's just good for where you are living, but it's also good for our environment. It is also not wasteful. Make this a habit in our families that we sit together and speak about, you know what, can we reduce our water usage, inshallah, in this month, so that we as believers, concerned citizens, we can show more appreciation to our deen and to the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على رسوله المصطفى وعلى من بآثاره اقتفى. Just on your behalf, I really want to thank our young brother, son here, Waleed Qazi, who is a fourth grader, who recited, was it Surah Al-Mutaffifin? Abasa. Before the, after the Adhan. And that was beautiful, mashallah wa tabarakallah. And that is part of the leadership built up in our school pillars. You know, when these young people come in here, they're not afraid of the mic, they're not afraid of facing the public, and they're able to express their identity and their deeds in the way that our young brother Waleed did here today is so beautiful, and that is something that is indeed worthy of our appreciation as well as our support. As we also thank the young brother for the recitation, cannot really miss out on thanking the teachers who actually helped these students. قَدِيمًا عَلَّمُونَ قَالْ حَنَانَيْكَ إِنِّي قَدْ بُلِيتُ بِصِبْيَةٍ أروح وأغدو كل يوم عليهم صغار نربيهم بملء عقولهم ونبنيهم ولكننا نتهدم فمن كان يرفي قلبه لمعذب فإن أجدر شخص بالرثاء المعلم على كتفيه يبلغ المجد غيره فما هو إلا للمجد أو فما هو إلا للتسلق سلم. And that's beautiful. You're just praising teachers for the type of work that they do. So again, inshallah, appreciating the young brother Waleed Qazi. Also, inshallah, we want to pray for brother Abdul Jalil, the father of Abdul Mateen, who passed away on Monday. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless his soul, ya Rabbul Alameen. Please take note, inshallah, of some very beautiful programs that are taking place. So tonight, inshallah, the Women Committee, they do have the movie night program. It will be tonight, inshallah, and they will be showing a movie, It's Better to Jump, about the Palestinians in the refugee camps. It's a beautiful movie that actually won an award, and I forgot the name of the award, but this is a beautiful, inshallah, event, and that is for the sisters. So please, inshallah, our sisters are invited to the movie tonight. Also tonight, inshallah, we will have our youth group at 7 o'clock as well. Next Friday, there is an important event, Treats and Tweets. Inshallah, make sure that on Friday when you come, please come to participate in a bake sale. This is the sale that is going, the revenue of it, inshallah, will be donated to help the Syrian refugees, the students in Jordan, to catch up on missed education. See, sometimes wars is just not about being safe. Even if you relocate somewhere else,
well, how do we have our kids continue education? How do we pay for their tuition? So now these kids are in Jordan, but they are unable to support themselves. So we want to make sure that inshallah next Friday that we come, we buy something and show our appreciation to these people. Also inshallah, next Saturday two events are happening. The monthly potluck will be here, and also Sheikh Ratib al-Nabulsi will be at the Hilton at 6 p.m. And again, it will be a fundraising for Syria. Outside, when you walk out, please Give Light Foundation event on February 16th to benefit the orphans. They do have a table outside. Please do stop by. And also, as always, visit our website, inshallah, to find out more about what is going on in our community. Once again, we like to pray for all the people who are being impacted by the drought. The Muslims as well as the non-Muslims. The ones that we know as well as the ones that we do not know. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease their difficulty, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provide us and them with plenty of rain, Ya Rabbal Alameen, that will bring us good blessings. And that will be an expression and manifestation of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ya Rabbi innaka afuun kareemun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Allahumma farrij hamma al-mahmumin wa nafis karba al-makrubin wa aqdi al-dayna an al-madinin. Allahumma arham mawtana wa asfi mardana wa fuk asrana wa afi mubtalana wa akhtum bilbaqiyati al-salihati ajalana bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma ya Rabbi innaka afuun kareemun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Allahumma aghnina bihalalika an haramin wa bifadlika an man siwaka. Allahumma aj'alna أفقر عبادك إليك وأغنى عبادك بك. اللهم يا رب اجعل الحياة زيادة لنا من كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.